Thank you. Thank you very much. So I'm a mathematician, and I'm an artist, and I mostly do visual art sculpture, but today I'm going to talk about what's current research on trying to develop techniques for doing mathematical performances, and I'll explain what I mean by that as I go along. But let me just sort of start to get us all on the same point by saying that, to me, mathematics is an art, and you can read this quote by Bertrand Russell, in which he famously compares mathematics to sculpture, that mathematics has this austere beauty. And if you're not a mathematician or if you haven't had advanced math courses, you might not realize, but what mathematicians do all the time is this creative field where they're creating ideas and structures that are beautiful. And if you're a math major, you learn, and the part of your training is to how to appreciate the beauty of math, that there's an aesthetic to what's a beautiful proof or what's an elegant theorem or whatever. And that there is this art aspect to mathematics. And I'm just going to start with that. I can give you a whole other lecture on what that's about. But what I want to talk about today is math as a performing art. So here's the real question. What's the mathematical analog to a performance that you go to, a symphony, an opera, a ballet, whatever, a theater performance, in which there's some sort of audience, a general audience comes in, and they're sitting in the audience, and up on the stage there's some people who are experts in their field of whatever that performance is, and the experts do something, and as a mathematician I want to convey some sort of true, beautiful mathematical experience, some real mathematical content to this audience, but I want you to have a kind of emotional experience. So the thing about a performance, as opposed to many visual arts, is that it has this drama, it has this development, it has conflicts and climax and resolution and whatever. And it has the ability over time to build this deep emotional connection to you. People come out of a performance and they're moved, they're enriched, and in a way often that they'll go tell their friends, what a great performance, you have to see it, come with me next time, whatever. There's a depth of human connection with a performance that I would say is different than what you have with static visual art sculpture. So how can I get there? But I'm going to start by telling what I mostly do, which is sculpture, just to give you a background. So as a mathematician, I think of myself as an applied mathematician applying math to sculpture. Math can be applied to all different fields, engineering and economics and social science, etc. I apply it to sculpture, and I create things, and I'll just show you random selections of things. You can see lots more on my website, georgehart.com, go there. These are things that I would love to tell you the whole story about, but that's not today's lecture. But you can see I enjoy working with many different materials, a range of different engineering problems. How do I work with steel? How do I work with CDs? How do I work with wood, plastic, et cetera, to create things. And the things that I'm creating are coming out of my head as mathematical ideas. So I start with mathematical foundations that, as a mathematician, I can see the beauty. But if you're not trained as a mathematician, you don't always know what's so beautiful about math. So I try and take something of that and convey it to you in some form that anyone can appreciate something about what's going on. And so as you look at these, you'll see various aspects of patterns and structures and relationships, and that's what mathematics is really about. The fundamental essence of mathematics is not about numbers or arithmetic or geometry or trigonometry, but in general, mathematics is the science or the study of patterns and understanding patterns and how things relate to each other. And you'll see there's all kinds of structures and patterns here. I'm obviously moved by things that relate to each other in interesting, complex ways. And I'm showing you sort of flavors of some of that. Some people often talk about the beauty of mathematical equations. That's something that people will tell you, Euler's formula, e to the I pi, is like one of the most beautiful equations. And it is in a way, but I want to emphasize that to a mathematician, it's not really the equation. When you see that equation, it really brings to mind a whole structure, that mathematicians never just believe something. We don't believe an equation, but we think of that equation in the context of how it was derived from all kinds of other facts and how it leads to other facts. So it's part of a structure. And a mathematician, when they look at anything, an equation or just anything in the real world, they see structures. They see these patterns. They think it at a more abstract level. And it's that beauty of structure which is what I'm trying to convey in these sculptures in different ways. And each has a different story, which I won't explain. But the kinds of things that, as a teacher, the professor in me wants to also have a kind of a pedagogical backstory when you look at these. And you might begin to ask mathematical questions. So you might say, when I look at that sculpture, you know, I might first of all try and count how many pieces are there, how many corners are there. This sculpture happens to have 30 pieces in it, each is sort of shaped like an X, and they each have some number. But you know, could I do that with 31? Could I do that with 29? There's something about the counting that might get you thinking in a mathematical frame of mind. There's also things about patterns. So you might look at the sculpture and begin to say, well, you know, how do those angles work? How do you calculate that length and angle? There's certain geometric questions that might come to mind, and that might sort of motivate you. Well, if I want to make cool things, maybe I should learn some geometry. And then there's this deeper issue of structure that when you look at a sculpture like this, you might think about, you know, how do these things relate? When I look at a sculpture, what I think about often is, can I visualize it in my mind? Can I close my eyes and see it? And I don't really feel like I know a sculpture until I can see it. I could go to a desert island and reproduce it, you know, in some form or another. So you might look at any of these and say, well, do I understand what's going on? Do I know, you know, can I see it from the other side? Could I answer questions about it? Could I reproduce it in clay or paper or something? And there's questions going on in many different fields. So some of these are sort of topological. They involve issues of topology. Some involve, you know, combinatorics or group theory, graph theory, symmetry. There's many branches of mathematics which are really beautiful, which, you know, the public doesn't see. The public goes through this, you know, arithmetic and algebra and trigonometry, maybe a little calculus. And that's all great stuff. It's really important, and it's crucial if you want to work up towards being like a scientist and understanding, you know, differential equations. You can't really understand how complex systems evolve without knowing a good intuitive sense of how differential equations work. And all that stuff is designed in the standard K through 12 and college curriculum to get you to that point, and it's great. But that's the tiniest fraction of what mathematics is. Real mathematics, as practiced by, you know, professional mathematicians, includes so much more. You know, sort of my mission in life is to sort of take this passion which I have for all these things and find some way to show them to the public. You know, this one is based on a uniform tessellation in the hyperbolic plane, which is this beautiful alternate geometry that I've mapped through the Poincaré disk into a form that you can see based on a, you know, spherical envelope. And that's the kind of thing which takes a long time to learn, but by seeing this, at least you can be exposed to the fact that these subjects are out there and that mathematicians find this so beautiful, so lovely. And I hope to inspire different people in different ways in these sculptures. And I would love to have, you know, lots of museums or places that you can view these things and, you know, see that this mathematical sculpture exists. And I should say that it's not just sculpture. One of the things I do is I organize a conference on mathematics and art every year, something called the Bridges Conference. You could look that up. We make a bridge between math and art. And well, I do sculpture, and, you know, I'm showing you my work. But at a conference like that, you'll find people from so many different fields. You know, there's people making, you know, oil paintings or watercolors and that sort of art. But there's people making quilts and people making beadwork and, you know, sundials or, you know, origami. Many, many different fields, different media. Can be used by people who are inspired by these, you know, fundamental mathematical beauties. Some of these sculptures that I'm showing are made on 3D printers. If you're familiar with sort of this modern revolution and be able to think of something, express it to the computer, hit the print button, and then you have it in your hand, it's just fascinating. It's so empowering that anything you can think of, these machines can build for you robotically. So it's a great reason to sort of learn about mathematics, because it's a language for expressing complex structures of whatever it is that you want to make. So I said I'd like to have museums of various sorts. And I should mention at some point that I've wanted that a long time, and I spent about 5 years of myself. I'm one of the co-founders of the Museum of Mathematics in New York City, so let me just give a commercial. If you happen to be in New York, 11 East 26th Street, go visit MoMath. While these are static works, the philosophy of the museum is to give you hands-on things. So you can walk in, and like a science museum, you do this or that, and then you have some kind of fun interaction, and that's designed to give you this emotional connection, and so you should check that out. That emotional connection is important, and that's as I'm sort of trying to lead up here to this topic of mathematical performance. This I won't describe, but I did some of this in the break, has to cut a bagel into two equal parts, and if you've never done that, you should go find out how that works. So this next set of pictures here that we're moving to involve things that I do as workshops or things as I do with groups of people that takes us into this idea of a performance. And while I'm, you know, devoted my life in some sense to, you know, visual art and sculpture and things of this sort, there's a fundamental fact that if you go to a museum and you see great stuff, you know, people don't cry at a museum in the way that you might go to a performance and people will cry. There's this much deeper emotional connection when you have this sweep of time and this ability to develop an idea and have this human involvement. So the real question here is how do we go from these things, which I'm not putting down, but they have a limitation, to things that are more of a performance sort of nature. And you might say, well, let's take some math experts and put them on a stage and have them do something. And, you know, so what would that thing be? Is there anything that math experts can do on a stage that would give you that emotional connection? And I think the answer there is probably no, if the audience just has to sit down and be passive. We're beginning to see some things here where I involve a group of people. But the fundamental issue, math teachers say that math is not a spectator sport, that you have to do math to get the math. And as a corollary, you have to do math in order to feel the math, to have this emotional connection. So what's happening here is that I've designed various ways in which people can be involved. So imagine you go into a concert hall, and you sit down, and the usher hands you a viola. Okay, and you're expected to play. You can't really do that because it doesn't work with violas. People can't play violas. I'm going to flip through these here and now move to the video, if we can cue the video. And so, video rolling. So with music, it takes certain skills to perform. But I'm going to show you here just a montage of clips of people perform, people who, when you see them in the audience here, they're the audience. But what I claim is that math is different from music because everyone can do math. Math is the science, the study of patterns and structures and relationships, and you've been doing that your whole life. You can do that. So these events, we have to think of those people as being in the audience, but unlike an audience that sits, it's an audience that participates, because you just have to add that ingredient if you're going to actually do any math. For me to convey any real math content, I can't just do that on a board. It doesn't work. It's not a spectator sport. But what you see here are these events where I design something. So I'm sort of the composer of the symphony, and I'm also the conductor, because I'm there getting these people to put things together. And they're doing real math. And that may not be clear, but there's different kinds of math that you can be doing. There's issues of counting and assembly. There's geometry issues. But part of what they're doing is sort of extending patterns. You get these mathematical exercises when they say, you know, 3, 5, 7, what's the next number in that sequence? That skill that your teacher was trying to convey to you is how to look at something, find a pattern in data, and then extend that pattern. That's a crucial idea, and that's so essential to mathematics in general. The patterns in math generally aren't numbers. That's a tiny bit of the subject domain of mathematics. But the ability to find a pattern. So these people might see a piece and a piece and a piece, and they have to figure out where should the next piece go? Should it go there? That's doing a kind of mathematics. They're also doing issues about structure. They're trying to understand how do these parts go together, that as they begin to do this, they're realizing that, oh, each of these openings has 5 different colors around it or something of that sort. So when I do these events, depending on the audience, I do them at different levels. So as I said with the development, some cases I'm bringing just pieces of cardboard there, and if we have enough time, we develop it sort of from zero. We have a major or long-term opera. In other cases, I have to give them sort of more specific steps, do this, do this, do this, sort of like a square dance teacher telling you put, you know, slot A into part B or whatever. And so this can be done at different levels. And what you're seeing are experiments. You know, as a researcher, my job is to sort of try out different things and experiment and see what happens. But there's real math content in each of these events. And the beauty of it to me is that as a professor, I don't have to just say, OK, I'm going to lecture to you on symmetry. But I say, let's make something. And we start building. And I have it sort of planned, but it always works out in some different way than you plan. You have to be willing to sort of improvise as you go along. But in the course of this, people are going to ask questions. They're just naturally curious. They're going to say, well, you know, how many parts do we need and why and how does this go together? And at each time that a question comes up, you have the opportunity of a teacher, it's one of these teachable moments, to give an answer when the audience isn't just forced to sit there, but they're actually, you know, involved. It's an answer that's relevant to what they're trying to do at that moment. It's an answer that they care about. In the context of where it's relevant. So it's a very different sort of teaching experience that can have much greater depth. And as I said, this this performance aspect of, you know, conflict can come in here, like I can't get this piece in, but they have to sort of resolve it one way or the other. And I don't always know how it's going to resolve, but I can say in general there is a happy ending to most of these performances. This is a recent one at Duke University, you know, so I'm using laser-cut steel here that's been powder-coated. Actually, there's laser-cut aluminum in orbs that in this case are, you know, 4, 5, 6, and 7 feet in diameter over a period of several hours to put this together. And it's an event that people get deeply invested in. And one of my measures to understand that it's successful is the you know, the smiles on people's faces and the things they tell me. But another great measure that I've noticed again and again is a kind of ownership. So what happens is when people are involved in this, after they're done, they'll bring their friend and they'll say, you know, I helped make that. You know, that's my sculpture. You know, they put one nut and one bolt, but it's their sculpture. Or they, maybe they spend 4 hours, you know, just in love with the process. Everyone has a different amount of involvement, but there is this feel of ownership. There is this strong emotional connection. Another thing that people are doing is they're solving puzzles. And solving puzzles is a great skill. So you need to develop this ability that someone says, here's a problem, I don't know how to solve it, and it's not like there's a homework problem and I know the answer. It's like it's a real problem, and you have to be comfortable with that. So I try and, you know, present people with as much of a challenge as I can. I don't say to them necessarily, here's what to do. I say, I think these things go together. Can you figure it out? And they're working on it to make that happen. So that skill to be comfortable facing a new puzzle that you don't know what to do when you try stuff and some doesn't work, that's the essential skill that you need to be a creative problem solver, you know, in real life. One other thing that happens is that at some point, I can step back. This always happens where we're working for a while, where things are coming together, and then someone will ask a question, and someone else, instead of me, will answer it, and I can just kind of relax and let them take over from there. That's when I feel like I've actually taught something, that they begin to become this problem-solving community working together to figure out how things go. And again, these are not, you know, quantitative assessment factors that let me know that that this is definitely working, but I know this is working in one way or the other. But this is just one sort of teaching performance. I'd like other people to sort of explore this. I'm sort of encouraging you to go on and figure out how to bring aspects of performance into mathematical thinking. And this particular sculpture right now is hanging, this is in the math department at Princeton University. But there's plans and ideas for lots of these things on my website, lots of places you can go. Thank you.